looking at Genesis 3, 1 through 6. And we're also going to be looking at St. John 10. I hope I wrote that down. Yeah, St. John 10 and 10. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Hath God said, You shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the tree of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, You shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, You shall not surely die. Pay close attention to that this morning. And the serpent, that subtle crafty enemy, said, You shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her. Now, these scriptures here go in so many different directions. There's so many messages right within that passage of scripture. I'd spoken to you and said that I was going to be preaching, and I will be. And when she saw, and when the woman saw that the tree was good, and I was going to talk to you, but I'm not doing that this morning because God laid something else upon my heart that I want to do that precedes that. But when the woman saw that the tree was good from her perspective, that's what I wanted you to dwell on 2 weeks ago. I told you I'd give you a to-go box to take home so you could dwell on that, and you can still dwell on that. From whose perspective are you looking at things? That thing that it presented to you, from whose perspective are you looking at that? But we want to go into St. John 10 and 10. And the serpent said unto the woman, You shall not surely die. That's a lie from the enemy. St. John 10 and 10. The thief cometh not. The way that is worded, that means he has one intent. He has one purpose. The thief cometh not but to. In other words, this is his single goal. This is his single focus. This is his single intent. He cometh not but. That's all he wants to do. He has no other intentions in mind. He has no other purpose in mind except to do what? To steal and to kill and destroy. But Jesus said, I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. I want us to look at those three words today, steal, kill, and destroy. And if Olivia would pull up those definitions, you say, I know what steal means. I know what kill means. But we're going to look at this this morning in a depth that maybe you haven't seen it before. But the enemy has one sole purpose. And before that he can destroy, he must kill. Before he can kill, he must steal. So we're going to look at that. So what does that word steal? It means to seize, to gain, or to win by skill or trickery. Now it has two meanings. That word has two different meanings, and I want us to focus upon both of those meanings because both of those meanings are important. The thief cometh not but to steal. That is his first step that he takes, is to steal. Now if he's going to steal, that means you have possession of it, right? This is not actually talking to the sinner. Because the sinner doesn't have God. The sinner doesn't have the Holy Ghost. The sinner doesn't have the peace of God. The sinner doesn't have the joy that comes from God. You might say, well, I see a lot of happy sinners. But their joy doesn't come from within. Their joy comes from, well, I just got a big check in the mail. Their joy comes, well, I went to the doctor, and the doctor says I got a clean bill of health. That's where their joy and their peace comes from, outward sources. But you see, the peace and the joy that we have, that treasure that we have inside of us, it does not come from the world. The world didn't give it to us, and the world cannot take it away from us. That's what we're going to talk about. So that word still means to seize, to gain, or to win by trickery, to take away by force, or without permission. So what is it that we have that the devil wants to steal in our life? He's not interested in your car. He's not interested in your house, because we're going to find out. Let's look at Genesis. What did the Lord tell? He said, you'll surely die. Well, did Adam and Eve literally lay down and die? And they put them in a coffin? No. So all this is spiritual. This is what you got to look at. It's from a spiritual viewpoint that we're looking at this. So when we're looking at stealing, the devil is not interested in stealing your house. The devil is not interested in stealing your car. He's not interested in taking your job. He's not interested in your bank account. He's not interested in any of those things. Now, he may use those things as an avenue to get to you. He may use those things as an avenue to bombard your faith and to try to weaken your faith in God. Because, you see, he cannot steal because the devil is not interested in the outward. He's not concerned about what kind of house you live in, what kind of car. He's not concerned about how much money you got in the bank. He's not concerned about any of those things. The thief cometh not but to. He has one intent and he has one purpose, and that is to destroy your soul. That is to destroy your soul. And before he can destroy your soul, before he can destroy you, I'm wanting to get there too. But before we're going to get into destroy, and it's going to be quite interesting. Have you ever noticed? And we're going to just jump at this, and then we're going to go back. But he says, the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. Well, I mean, you think kill would be the final, huh? You think kill would be the final, once he kills you. But it is not. It's not. He will destroy. What is he destroying? I'm already gone. He's destroyed your light. He's destroyed your testimony. He's destroyed your witness to those that's out there in the world. Those that could see your light will no longer be able to see your shining light. Those that would come to the light because of the light of Jesus Christ that lives inside of you. Those that have heard your testimony. How many of you have testified, I'm not going to quit? You know what? Other people have heard that too. They've heard you say, I'm not going to give up. They've heard you say, I'm not going to quit. And you see, even after he has stolen, and even after he has killed you, and again, it's not talking about physically killing you, and that could be there and factored in as well. But he's talking about spiritually killing you. He's talking about spiritually killing you. So when we look at this and we see, well, what is it that I have that the enemy wants? What is it that I got that he wants? And you know, some of the things the Lord, I want us to look at Luke, the 12th chapter. To really get this scripture, we've got to look at Luke, the 12th chapter. And we're going to begin reading at the 37th verse. And I don't know how far I'm going to get because, again, these scriptures are so many scriptures that's involved in this, and there's so many thoughts that's involved in this, and we want to try to get it line upon line, precept upon precept. I want you to receive the message that God has in store for you. Now, I'm going to tell you what, do you know some of the scriptures still being revealed to me? You might think, well, Brother Rob, you've been preaching all these years. Surely you, every scripture, you've got the revelation. No. This morning I was reading, and I got the revelation of a scripture that I never really understood, never really heard anybody preach it to satisfy my understanding, but the Spirit of God gave me something this morning on this scripture. So I want us to read this. Blessed are those. How many wants to be blessed? You hear them talking, the radio, TV preachers, you hear them talking about blessed. God wants to bless you. God wants to bless. Well, this is the kind of blessing that I want. This is the kind of blessing that I want. I don't need more money in my pocket. In fact, I think America needs less money. Because when they had less money, America was closer to God. When we didn't have so much to spend, we spent more time with God. We spent more time with prayer and prayer. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, don't know when, and find them, so blessed are those servants. We don't know what watch he's going to come. No man knows the day nor the hour that he's going to come. And this know that if the goodman of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched. And I'm going to throw this in right now. If people in Bayou would know today Jesus was coming, if people in Bayou knew today that Jesus was coming, because the Bible says he's going to come as a thief in the night, isn't he? So if they knew today, do you think people be doing what they're doing right now? Yeah. Do you think there'd be anything that would keep them out of the house of God? What are people doing today? They're doing this, they're doing that. Well, I got to do this, I got to do, and they don't have time for God anymore. But I can guarantee you, if they knew without a doubt, think about this. If everyone knew without a doubt that Jesus was going to come sometime today, you'd think they'd be out on the water fishing and skiing or whatever they're doing. You'd think they'd be just sitting at home doing nothing. Or do you think the church houses would be full? I'm telling you, we wouldn't have room to sit the people. The Baptist church wouldn't have room. All the churches in Bayou Saul would not even be able to accommodate the people. They would be standing in line. They would be packed in here like sardines. If we knew, you can't tell me. You can't tell me that some of the people that's out there right now would be living the life that they're living if they knew that Jesus was going to come today. You can't tell me that. You know, there was this old song, if Jesus had come to your house, Jesus would come knock on your door. What would you be doing? If Jesus came and knocked on your door, would you be carrying on, arguing and fighting and carrying on? What would you be doing if Jesus came and knocked on your door? You know, he's fixing to enter your house. What kind of shape would your house be in? Well, we better worry about this house. What kind of shape is this house in? Because I'm telling you, we don't know what day nor hour. We don't know at what watch he's going to come. But the Bible says that the goodman of the house would have known what hour the thief would come. He would have watched. And he would not have suffered his house to be broken into. And let's go ahead and read it, because I wanted to get into that because I want to get back to that, but I want to read it all to give you the full meaning of this. Be ye therefore ready also, for the Son of Man cometh at an hour when you think not. In other words, I got plenty of time. Some of you might be sitting here today and say, I got plenty of time to get my heart right with God. Some of you may be sitting here and say, well, maybe I'll go to church tonight and get my heart right with God. I'm telling you, Jesus can come while I'm preaching today. And are you ready to go? Are you ready to go? If Jesus would come right now, are you ready to go? Then Peter said unto him, Lord, speakest thou this parable unto us, or even to all? Are you just talking to us? Peter said, are you just talking to us, or are you talking to everybody? I'm telling you, he's talking to whosoever will. He's talking to everybody. And the Lord said unto him, who is this, that faithful and wise steward, whom the Lord hath made ruler over his household, to give them their portion of meat in due season? Blessed is that servant whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find him so doing. Not just talking about it, not what you're going to do, but you're going to find that servant doing. There's a lot of people know the book, and they can even quote scriptures, but they're not doing. And when you stand before God, you're not going to stand before God with the knowledge that you have in God's Word. Well, God, I know. And it's going to be, well, we're going to find out a little bit later on how much sadder it's going to be for those people that really do know the depth of God. Let's read it. Of a truth I say unto you, that he will make him ruler over all that he hath. But, and if that servant say in his heart, say in his heart, not with just the mind. Because I'm going to tell you what, the mind talks to us sometimes, and we got to cast those thoughts out of the mind. But here's where the thief wants to steal. He wants to get that which is inside of your heart. Again, he's not interested in this outward man. He wants to get inside of your heart, and he wants to gain possession of your heart. He wants to steal that treasure that you got on the inside of you. But if that servant say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming. Do you know there's a lot of people right now? Now, I want us to understand. We're going to look at this household and what is it that's in this house? Okay? So keep in mind, my Lord delayeth his coming. How many of you looked for Jesus 20 years ago? And you know what? There's a lot of people said, well, he hadn't come yet, so, you know, I don't know. I probably got 20 more years. My Lord delayeth his coming. But he's going to come as a thief when you're not expecting him. You better watch. My Lord delayeth his coming and shall begin to beat his men servants and maid servants. I never did get this. And when you just read it, think about it. He begins to beat his men servants and his maids and to eat and drink and to be drunken. And, you know, again, I've never heard it preached. I don't guess I've heard it preached to my satisfaction. I heard it preached to where I really got the meaning of this scripture. But I was studying this morning, and the Lord began to deal with me about this. And it doesn't, you know, in the past, it seemed like it just didn't fit in. But then all of a sudden, as the Lord began to reveal, you see, this is the servant that has been given a household. And within this household, he has men servants and he has maid servants. They're in his possession. He owns those men servants and those maid servants. They belong to him. And he said, but if the servant say to his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming. Now, within us, this is the house that God has given us. This is the temple that God has given us. We don't have men servants and maid servants inside of this house, but he's trying to get a message across. Understand that when the Spirit of God tries to relay a message, he uses parables so that we can get a grasp of meaning of what he's trying to talk about. And all of a sudden became clear the meaning of what he was trying to tell us this morning in his word. We have a house. How many know the Bible said this is the temple of the what? Your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost dwells within you. Joy dwells within you. Peace, all these things dwell within you. You know what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians? And let's see where I have it at. 2 Corinthians 4 and 7. For we have this treasure in earthen vessels. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We got a treasure inside of us. And that treasure that we have inside of us is equipped with power. What did he say when I'll send you the Holy Ghost? I'll give you power over all of the powers of the enemy. But where does that treasure abide? It abides within his heart. So what did the servant say? He said it in his heart. See, he's speaking to the heart. Just like the rich man. And the Bible says, I'm going to tear down my barns and I'm going to build me bigger barns. But he said, thy fool, this night thy soul is required of thee. The most important thing. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. So there's a treasure inside of us. Now, all kind of things can come against you. And some of you are going, maybe you're going through some hard, difficult things in your life right now. And what is the devil trying to do? He's trying to steal. But what is he trying to steal? He's not interested in your money. He's not interested in your body, whether it's well or sick. He's not interested in anything outside of you. What the devil is interested in is your heart. He wants to gain access to the heart. And I'm going to tell you what. He cannot steal your joy. He cannot steal your peace. He cannot steal anything that is inside of the heart, as long as you keep it sealed with the Holy Ghost. But that's what the devil is after. The devil is wanting to steal. And he'll do everything that he can, because he wants you to doubt. He wants you to begin to question God. He wants you to open up that door. Because again, you open the door for him to come in, and you're the only one can open the door for him to go out. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. You open the door for him to come in. Because I tell you all the time, the doorknob is on the inside. There is no doorknob on the outside. God is not going to open your heart's door. You got to open your own heart's door. And when you open up your heart and you let him come in, he said, I'll come in and abide with you. I'll sup with you and you'll sup with me. In other words, we'll feast on the spiritual things of God. Because the whole world, your ship can be tossed to and fro. And I mean your sails can be torn. And your ship can be beaten. But you know what? As long as Jesus is inside of you, you're going to keep floating. As long as Jesus is abiding within your heart, though the outward man perish, this inward man is renewed day by day. The devil may try to steal your joy. He may try to steal your victory. And you may, for a moment, you may lose your laughter. For a moment, you may seemingly even lose your joy. For a moment, you may seemingly lose it. Why? It's because of the outward. That's what's taking place on the outward side. But you know what? When the enemy comes in like a flood and he tries to take it and he rolled all that away from you, he can't do anything. Why? Because your house is built upon a rock, right? Christ Jesus, and that rock is going to stand firm. That rock is not going to be washed away. That's another parable. But it gives us a clearer understanding of what I'm trying to say to you today. So when Jesus lives inside of your heart, you know why a lot of people come? They last a little while and they end up leaving and quitting. Because they didn't really get him inside the heart. They didn't really get him inside of the heart. But when you really get him in the heart, you see, the enemy, now don't get me wrong, the enemy is going to come against you. The enemy is going to come against you with everything that he had. He's going to war against you to try to get you to doubt and try to get you where. He uses the natural things of the world. He'll use sickness. He'll use finances. He'll use family problems. He'll use everything that he has to get you to open up your heart. So how did you do that? Well, you know how you opened up your heart? Through what? Faith? And belief in God? The way you opened it up to let him out is through doubt and unbelief. You see? So this is what the devil is working on. He's wanting to steal. But you know what? We need to declare war on the devil. And we need to say, devil, you are not going to take. You are not going to take that which God has given me. That which God has placed within me. I have a treasure inside of me. That the excellency of the power, that excellent power. You see, my power is not excellent. My power has flaws. Your power has flaws. But his power is excellent. There are no flaws in his power. How many of you have tried to work things out your own self? You tried to work situations out your own self. And you'll find out when you go to try to work out situations out your own self, you'll make more of a mess than you can fix it. But when we find out that the excellency of the power is of God and not of us, when we got that treasure, that's why the devil wants to take that treasure, because you'll have no one that can really help you fix your problem anymore. You'll have to totally lean upon the arm of flesh. But you see, as long as you got God, I don't care what kind of mess you get in. I don't care what kind of mess your life gets in. I don't care what kind of circumstances that you get into life. As long as you got that treasure on the inside of you, you might say, you know, we've all lost loved ones. We've all gone through times in our life. And this outward man, and we feel all the pressures. We feel the sadness. And we've been made joyful our night. We've been made, even for Christians. Even for Christians, we've been made endure for a night. Why does it endure? Why does it just endure for a night? Because it's only affecting the flesh. It lasts a lot longer when it gets into the heart and gets into the soul. It's for eternity. They'll be weeping, the Bible says. They'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. In hell, they'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Weeping's not going to endure by night. It's going to be through all eternity. But there'll be no one there to wipe the tears from your eyes. Weeping may you endure by night, but joy is going to come in the morning. And I tell you this quite often. You may be physically weeping, and you may be going through one of those moments, through one of those spells, one of those seasons, that tears are flowing down your eyes. And Jesus comes. He breaks through the clouds of glory. But what does the Bible say? And God himself shall wipe away all the tears. So what does that tell me? What does that tell you? Some of us are going to be going through hard times. Some of us are going to be in situations that is going to cause tears to flow. Even when Jesus breaks through the clouds of glory. But you know what? We still are going to be watching. we're still going to come to the house of God. What is it that brought you to the house of God this morning? I guarantee you it wasn't this old flesh. What is it that caused you to want to come walk through those doors? I guarantee you it wasn't because, oh, everything is going so good in my life. I can't wait to get to the house of God to testify about everything. And you may have those moments. For everything, there is a season and a time to everything. There's a time to be born. There's a time to laugh. There's a time to weep. And there's a time to mourn. This is in life. There's going to be times we're going to be laughing. There's going to be times we're going to be mourning. There's some of you may have gone through situations in your life and you say, I'll never laugh again. I see no reason to ever put a smile on my face again. Weeping may endure for a night. And sometimes that night is, you know, God's time is not our time. That night may be a long night. It may be a long night. But joy is going to come in the morning. And I'm telling you, it may be on this side, it may be on this side of eternity that God's going to work things out, that God's going to answer your prayer and do whatever you want Him to do. And it may be on this side that you'll be laughing again. And it may be on this side that you'll have that joy, even on the outward, you'll have that joy. But for all of us, even if we're weeping, we don't know what we're going to be going through before this is over when we get to the end of this race. But I can tell you what, when we step through those pearly gates, the Bible says God Himself is going to wipe away all the tears. So the devil is wanting that inner joy. The devil is wanting that inner peace that doesn't come from the world. But it comes from a relationship with God. But the thief cometh not, but to steal, kill, and destroy. Let's look at Luke. Where was it? Luke 12. Let's go back to Luke 12. But if the servant say to his in his heart, that's where it's got to get, in the heart. You see, that's what Satan is working on, the heart. Because he wars against his flesh and he wars against his blood. But when the heart begins to speak, you see, and this is what this servant is doing. He's done got to the point where the Lord's done delayed His coming. He's not coming like He said He was coming. I've been serving, and some of you may be getting a little bit weary. I've been serving God for years. I've been hearing the preacher preach for years that Jesus is coming. Well, He hadn't come yet. And you know what? There's a lot of them out there today that are doing their own thing on Sunday morning. Their kids, which ought to be in the house of God, hearing the Word of God. What are they doing with them? They're going here with them and going to do that with them and they're going to do this with them and they're doing all kinds of things except bringing them to the house of God to hear the Word of God. They done got to the point. They may tell you verbally, they may say, well, I still believe in the Bible. I still believe that Jesus is coming. But if you believe that Jesus is coming, then you believe that Jesus could come today. You see the way the devil deceives? He doesn't mind people saying that Jesus is coming. The servant, I know he's coming, but he's delayed his coming. He doesn't care. There's a lot of people, you'll talk to them, oh, I believe in the Bible and I believe Jesus is coming again. But what does their life, what kind of life are they living? If Jesus would come today, would they be ready to go meet Him? If Jesus would come today, is there something between them and God that would keep them from getting through into heaven? Because if you really believe, you're going to take action. If you really believe, that Jesus is coming, you're going to take action. So he began to beat his men servants, and what that means is he began to abuse. Beat means to abuse, right? I want y'all to know there's people, and here's what the Lord showed me. There's people that's abusing that possession that God has given them. People are abusing it. The Lord is delaying his coming. He's not coming. So how do you abuse that which is inside of you? How do you possibly abuse that by not using it? You abuse it by not using it. You understand that? Abuse. A-B-U-S-E. Y'all got that? Abuse. A-B-U-S-E. Abuse. Not use. Not use. So when we think about abuse, when we think about abuse, we just think about it on the beating. But the Lord's wanting us to know today, this is spiritual that he's speaking about. And when you don't use the gifts that's in your life, that God has placed within your life, you're abusing those things. Let me tell you something. You can let a house set up with nobody living in that house, and that house is going to go down to nothing. You ever seen that? It's abuse. In a way, it is abuse. Because it's not being used. There's no life in that house. So when you don't use those things that God has given you, you're abusing that precious treasure. When you don't use the power that is inside of you. So we need to start using that power. You know, if we're not careful, we'll let the devil run all over us. We'll let the devil beat us up, and he does this with the mind. He comes in like a flood, and I mean he just comes against us with everything that he has. But we got to recognize what we have on the inside of us. And we got to realize that we have a power. We have a treasure. And again, what the devil wants to possess, he wants to possess that treasure. He wants to take away that treasure. How many knows if you walked into somebody's house and if you went to break into somebody's house, you're not going to go steal the few little dishes and bowls and stuff like that. What are you going to be looking for? You're going to look for the diamonds. You're going to look for those things that are of value. And I'm going to tell you what. What's inside of this heart here, it's valuable. But you know what? If you're smart, if you got a lot of valuables, even in your house, if you got a lot of valuables, where are you going to keep those valuables? You're going to keep them locked away in a safe place. I'll give you power after that, the Holy Ghost. And the Bible says he seals us with the Holy Ghost. And we got to keep that seal, because if we don't, the enemy is going to come in and take that treasure that we have. But you know what? He said also, I'll give you the keys. Y'all got that one? How many got the key to the treasure box? You don't give that key to anybody, do you? If you got a safe deposit box and it's got a lot of valuables in it, you're not just going to go around carelessly laying that key aside where anybody can take it and steal that key and go get your valuables. He said, I'll give you the keys to the kingdom, that whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loosen on earth will be loosened in heaven. He has given us the key. And we're the only one that can open it up. And you know what the devil is wanting you to give up this morning? There's some of you sitting here today. The devil is wanting you to give up. He's wanting you to release that treasure. Because you know what? He knows there's nothing he can really do with you as long as you got that excellency of the power living inside of you. He's done tried everything. I mean, he's afflicted the body. He's afflicted the family. He's afflicted the finances. He's done everything that he possibly can to bring you down, to wear you out. Be not weary in well-doing. Keep fighting. He's done everything that he can to bring you down. Why? so that you would begin to doubt God. And then you would open up through doubt and unbelief. And once you open up, what happens? He'll steal. And the Bible says, and they began to eat and drink and be drunken. In other words, they're drunk on the things of the world. They're getting totally intoxicated on the things of the world. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. We got to keep our priorities straight. God is the most important thing in our life. And they began to eat and drink and be drunken. What does the Bible say? Be sober. Be vigilant. Watch. Be sober, be vigilant. Tying these scriptures together. Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, goes about seeking whom he can do what? Devour. But we've got to be sober. In other words, that saying that goes along with this scripture. Don't get drunk. Don't get intoxicated on the things of the world. Let me tell you, the devil can't get you one way, he'll get you another way. If he can't get you through trials and tribulations and all the, if he can't bring you down that way, then prosperity. You'll be like the rich young fool. I'm going to tear down my bones and build. And you get consumed with that. You get drunk. And I'm going to tell you, one of the worst dangers in America today is not having too little. One of the most dangers in America today is having too much. And with too much, you don't have enough time for God. But the Lord of that servant will come in a day when he looketh not for him. And in an hour when he is not aware. And he will cut him in sunder and will appoint him his portion with the unbelievers. In other words, you're going to hell. And that servant which knew the Lord's will, this is why I want y'all to pay close attention to this. And that servant which knew the Lord's will, and I'm going to tell you what, there's a lot of people that knows the Lord's will. They know it's God's will to be in church this morning. They know it's God's will to serve God. But what are they doing? They're serving the flesh. Whatever the flesh wants, that's what they want to do. They're serving the flesh. But they know the Lord's will. You'd be surprised. I mean, honey, you wouldn't be surprised. But how many people in my soul know? They know this book. A lot of them can quote scripture. They know it. They know the Lord's will. But listen to what the Bible says. And that servant which knew his Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. I'm going to tell you what, church. There are some people that don't have the knowledge, all the knowledge that we have. There are some people that haven't been taught the Word of God in the manner in which we have been taught and others have been taught. But there are others that don't have the depth of God's Word that we have. And you may look at them and you may judge them. And you might say, well, Brother Al, they go to this church, but they sure don't do the way we do. Well, maybe they haven't been taught all of God's will. Here's what the Bible says. I want you to get this. You might say, oh boy, I enjoy that preaching. But you know what? You're going to be accountable for every word you hear. You can't judge yourself according to, you can't measure yourself according to another man. You're going to be, you know what? How you're going to be judged? You're going to be judged according to the words that you've heard. You're going to be judged according to the preaching and the interpretation of the Word of God that you have received. You're going to be judged according to that. How do I know? Well, let's read it. See what the Scripture says. And that servant which knew the Lord's will and prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. So what we're looking at here, let's go ahead. But he that knew not and did commit things worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. But unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall be required, and to whom Men have committed much, of him shall they will ask of more. I'm going to tell you, we've been given a lot, church. What point I'm trying to get across to you today is, I don't want to go to hell anyway. No matter, beat with few stripes or many stripes, it doesn't matter. But according to this, what the Word of God says here, those that know more, those that have been taught more, and you go away from God, and you say the Lord's delaying is coming, and you walk away from God, the Bible says you are going to be beaten with many stripes. Again, that's spiritual. What is it talking about? Somebody going to take a whip and whip me? No, that's talking about in hell. That's talking about in hell. You're going to be beaten with many stripes. Just like there's rewards in heaven. We maybe haven't taught this before, but there's rewards in heaven. You're going to be given certain rewards in heaven for what you do down here on earth. There's certain rewards, you see. Now, again, I want my rewards when I get to heaven, but I'm aimed to want to get to heaven. But the same way, hell, Lord, have mercy, hell. I don't want to go to hell. It's going to be more torment. According to what the Scripture says here, there's going to be more torment. And let me tell you where I believe the torment is going to come. I believe this is where the torment is going to come. Because you had so much more knowledge. And you had so much more potential. You could have done so much more. You could have done so much more for God because you had been taught. And to whom much is given, here's what the Word says, much is required. You can't go by somebody that hasn't been taught in the depth that you've been taught. You can't look at other people and say, well, look what they're doing. You can't do that. You know what? Every man got to work out his own. You got to walk with God by the light that you have received from God. And again, you can't measure someone else, and you can't measure yourself according to someone else. You got to measure yourself according to the Word. But there are some people that haven't been given as much as we have been given. The debt that we have received. The way that the presence of God. And don't get me wrong, I believe that there's Christians in all these churches that, you know, they believe in Jesus Christ and they believe the blood washes away their sin. And you have to believe that. You have to believe that the blood washes away your sin, and there's only one. Now, other churches that don't believe in that, then they're not gonna have access to God. But if they believe that their sins are washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ, and they have confessed with the mouth, and they have believed in the heart, this is what the Bible says, and you shall be saved. And then what do? You begin to walk in the knowledge that you have that God gives you according to His Word through the anointed preaching of the Word of God. You begin to walk in that. So you see, we can kind of go through a form and kind of go through a ritual, but we've been taught spiritual warfare. We've been taught how to fight. We've been taught how to pray. We've been taught we can't relinquish and give to the devil, and we've got to fight. We've been taught that. But I believe that the greater torment in hell is going to be when you realize I had so much to offer. And you're looking around hell and you see, you know, those parents that didn't bring their kids to church. And they didn't, you talk about torments. The Bible talks about the rich man in hell was in torments. S on the end, plural. Those parents that didn't bring those kids to church, what does the Bible say? Train them up in the way they should go. So when they're old, they won't depart. But they don't bring them to church. They bring them everywhere else. School is number one. This is number one. That's number one. Everything else is number one. But church is always secondary. And let me tell you, God is the most important. David said, one thing have I desired, and this I got one single focus, because the devil's got one single focus, is to bring me down, and I've got one single focus. One thing have I desired, and this will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, that I may inquire of Him and behold the beauty of the Lord. A single, single focus. We got to have a single focus. Hallelujah. Too many. Unstable man got double vision. Unstable man got double vision. You can't read with double vision. You can't see clear with double vision. Some people's not seeing clear because they got double vision. But you can only have single vision. One thing have I desire, and this will I seek after. Not bringing their kids to the house of God. And then in hell, they look at, and don't tell me it doesn't happen, because what does the Bible say about the rich man in hell? Rich man in hell, you may not want to testify, because you know what? You got plenty of time in hell. You don't have anything to do in hell except burn and be in torment. Now, I know this is not a popular message today. Brother Ralph, I didn't come to church to hear about hell and all that. Well, you go find another church, because this church still believes that there's a hell. We believe that there's a heaven and we're trying to get to heaven, but we also believe that there's a hell and there is no in between. Forget about somebody trying to pray you out of hell once you get there.
That's right. Amen.
You're not going to hear this too much. But you're looking around, and I believe the greater torment, the greater beatings. And this is my way of thinking, because fire is fire to me. Fire burns. How many know fire burns? And they're going to be a lake of fire, right? So they're all going to be a lake and a lake of fire. But what brought that rich man in hell? What brought him torments? He looked up and he saw Lazarus. You're going to look up. I went to that same church. I heard the same preaching. That sister so-and-so was up there. I heard the same. I could be there, but no, I was too busy. We had to go to the beach. And don't get me wrong, I'm not actually preaching about going to the beach, or I'm not actually preaching about going fishing or going swimming. We all do those things. But we got to get our priorities straight. We got to get our focus straight, because the devil never loses his focus. You may get off the focus, but the devil got you. He's got you targeted. So looking up in hell, the Bible says this. You read it. In hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torments. And he saw Lazarus in Abraham's bosom, safe and secure. And this is what brought him some more of his torments. And then it goes on to say, y'all notice it doesn't stop there. Father Abraham, I have five brothers, I believe it was. I didn't have anything to witness to them about. But I want you to send Lazarus that he may go to my brothers. You may not try to get people to come to church now. You might say, well, bless God, if they want to come, let them come. They know where the church is. Let me tell you, a lot of people know where the drugs are, but there's always some enticing you. A lot of you young people, you're sitting here, you know where you could get it at. But there's going to be somebody, when you start growing up, there's going to be somebody come and offer it to you. The way you first took your first your first pills or whatever you took, there's going to be somebody offering it to you. And the one you got to watch today is the doctor. Let me say that again. Some of you don't believe it, but it's the truth. The one you got to watch today is the doctor. And am I preaching against medicine? No, I take medication. But you got to learn, don't let it control you. You control it. And when it gets to the point where it becomes addictive to you, when it gets to the point where you're no longer in pain, but you're still taking, how many of you know that happens? If you're no longer in pain, but you like the way it makes you feel. It's gone beyond medication now. It's an addiction now. So there's going to always be somebody. I remember going to the doctor. I'll tell you this story. I remember going to the doctor. I just had surgery. Well, the pain wasn't that great. I mean, you know, sometimes you got to learn to put up with a little pain. The pain wasn't that great, but he wanted to give me Oxycontin. Well, Lord, it didn't take me long. Say, hey, I don't even look at that stuff. I don't want that stuff even in my house, because I saw the damage that that stuff has done. But there'll always be somebody there offering you offering you something. So why not as children of God? And what are they leading you into? They lead you into eternity of hell if you don't get straight. And what do we have to offer? We have a treasure. We have a treasure. And you know what? Out of your belly shall flow what? Of what? That's part of that treasure. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. I'm going to tell you what I do. With my kids, my grandkids, and with this church, everybody that I can possibly reach. One thing I want to do to them, even before I say a word about preaching, I want to be an example. I want to be an example. Because I'm going to tell you what, it's like I tell you about this light. That light doesn't have to say a word sometime. Well, it doesn't have to say a word at any time. But just using that as an example, that light doesn't have to say a word, but it shines. It dispels darkness. And when you walk into a place, people are going to know there's going to be something different about you. But different from that natural light, we have a light that God speaks to us and tells us to go into all the world and be a witness. That's what the Word of God says. Be a witness. Take that light and be a witness. Sometimes you do it with your mouth. Sometimes you just do it with your presence. But be a witness. Because there are people that's dying and going to hell. The Lord delayed His coming. He's not coming. But let me say in closing, I can guarantee you, how many people have come through by yourself? How many have come through this church? How many have sat on these pews? But the pull of drugs was too much. The pull of lust was too much. The pull of this was too much. And the pull of that was too much. You know why? Because they let the flesh. But if they can get Him in the heart, the pull of drugs, the pull of lust, none of those things. Because we all going to fight things. But if we can get Him in the heart, none of those things are going to stop us. So you leave this place today and you let your light shine to that lost and dying world that's dying and going to hell. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your word that You have spoken to us. We thank You, God, that Your word goes forth as a light in this dark world that we're living in. And we ask, oh God, that this word goes forth into our hearts and accomplishes that which You want it to do. We ask, oh God, that You would anoint us to be lights in this dying world. We ask, oh God, that You would anoint our lips, that You would anoint our hands, that You would just let that anointing flow through us, God, that we may reach out to those that's lost in this dying world that we're living in. Let the words that we've heard this morning go deep into our hearts, because there's much that is required of us today. And we don't want to be beaten with those many stripes. Just the knowledge of what we have can bring life today, but that same knowledge that we have can bring torments if we don't use it and end up going to hell. And I ask, oh God, that You would continue to lead us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray.